Well, welcome to Christ Fellowship. My name is Stephen. Hey, I love Jennifer's story. It represents so many of us who have decided that spectator church isn't for us anymore, that we're going to engage with our kids and our families and our friends like never before. And maybe you know someone right now that needs to jump into church with you right now. You got your phone in with you. Go ahead, send them a text. Say, hey, I'm in church. I think you need to be encouraged today. Come in, jump, come to church with me. You can do that right now. So go ahead, share this link or this Facebook page or wherever you're at. Share this with them. Let them come to church with you. Hey, we're going to jump right into worship. So I want you to know God is with you. He is with you. Hey, Sea of Kids worship team, man, you are spread out all over the place. I want you to lead your neighborhoods, your houses like never before. Zia Lopez, are you ready? Are you ready to dance? Get your guitar. Let's go. Miles Robertson, I want to hear you so loud today. Come on, let's enter his presence with thanksgiving. God, there is freedom in your presence. There is freedom in this place. Wherever your people are gathered in your name, you are with them. And so we worship you with all that we have today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen.
Break into the wild and don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is,
Enough to move mountains and personal enough to hear the cries of our heart. And what I want you to hear is that this week, God has been moving mountains. We have been praying for you. You have been sending in your requests for prayer, and we have seen him move some mountains. You know, if you want us to pray for you, you can send in your prayer request. You can just text the word prayer to 441-441. We have a 24-hour prayer line going. You can also just type the word prayer in the chat right there, and we'll reach out and pray for you. But this week, we had some amazing answers to prayer that I just want to share with you. You know, Jason, his 83-year-old dad, who was suffering with COVID-19, he was cured this week. Jamie's been healed of the COVID-19 virus. Jerry's mom that was admitted to the hospital on Sunday with pneumonia has already been released and she is healed. Robert, and I love this, Rob and his wife have been reconciled. Their marriage has been restored. And I just believe that God is a mountain moving God. And what I want, why I share these praise reports with you, is because I believe he wants to do it again. I believe that he wants to move your mountain. So if you have a mountain that he needs to move, I've got some requests here from some of you that sent them in today before the service. And I want to pray for Farrah's friend. We want to pray right now for Farrah's friend, Jenny, who is positive of the COVID-19. God, we pray for Jenny. Even now, we pray, God, that you would send your healing power to her. We pray that you would send your healing power to all those that are suffering. For Adriana, who's on her father's on a ventilator right now. We pray, God, that you would go to him right now and heal him. We want to pray for Carrie and his wife, who both lost their jobs. We pray for Carrie and for all those who have lost their jobs in this season. God, we believe that you are a God who provides. And so we pray that you will be their provider. We pray for all those who are finding themselves in financial difficulties, that you would come through and do it again. For Denise, you're praying for salvation for your family. We pray, God, for all those who have lost loved ones. We pray for your power in their lives today. We're praying for Brad as his protection as a truck driver, as he's on the front line, keeping our supply chain. We pray, God, that you be with Brad and all those on the front line, those who are providing for us daily. God, we believe that you are moving mountains and you are a mountain moving God. I have a scripture for you for those I just prayed for, and for if you need prayer, this is a scripture just to stir your faith. See, Ephesians 3:20 says this: we can come to God boldly. We can believe that he's going to move mountains because of this. It says, never doubt God's mighty power to work in you and to accomplish all of this. He will achieve infinitely more than your greatest request, your most unbelievable dream, and he will exceed your wildest imagination. He will outdo them all, for his miraculous power constantly energizes you. Do you believe it, church? Let's sing this again and declare that we serve a God who wants to do it again. Let's sing together.
Church, I love that song. We have seen God do so many incredible things in years past, but the beautiful thing is that right now in this season, we're still seeing God do some incredible things. And so we're so, so thankful for that. We are also thankful that you are joining with us online today. Welcome to Church Online at Christ Fellowship. And you know what? The reality is, church looks a lot different right now. You may have kids crawling all over you. I don't know. What? Hey, get out of here. Sorry, guys, but like I said, you may have some kids crawling all over you, but you know what? Chloe, where's my co-host? Chloe, are you on? Are you there? Help me out.
Pastor Travis, I'm here. I got it. That was awesome. Hey, church family, we are so glad to see you. We hope you're doing well. I just wanted to encourage you to share this service with somebody you know. It's never been easier to share service than it is right now. You can jump on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube to share the service. My favorite way is just to copy the link, put it in a text message, invite your loved ones to watch church with you.
Yeah, and you know what? If you are watching with us right now, and maybe you have a prayer request, maybe you have a question for us, we love for you to connect with us. If you want, you can take out your phone and text the word connect to 441-441, and our team is going to be right there ready to serve you and your family in any way that we can. But I want to tell you, there's something big coming up. Tell us about it, Chloe. Come on.
Oh, Pastor Travis, you know I'm excited because ladies, where my ladies at? I know they're in their living rooms right now saying, I'm right here, girl. Listen, girl, Friday night, May 8th, 7 p.m., we are having Sisterhood Night. It's going to be such a special night of worship, fun, encouragement. You know, Pastor Julie, there's going to be surprises. So I hope that you'll join us. Text your girlfriends. We're going to have Christine Kane and Pastor Julie. It's going to be such a special night. So make sure you're there May 8th, 7 p.m. Don't miss it.
That's going to be incredible. And you know what? Next weekend is Mother's Day. And coming from the biggest mama's boy out of everybody, I can't wait for Mother's Day. It's one of my favorites. And so shout out to Lynette O'Neill. But we are so excited about that, to celebrate all the special ladies in our lives. So guys, get some flowers, get some chocolates, get ready to celebrate next weekend. It's going to be great.
That's right, Pastor Travis. It's going to be awesome. Hi, Mom. Listen, church, we had the awesome opportunity to be a part of something really special in our community this past week. So we're going to throw it to our very own pastors for them to tell us more about it.
Hey everybody, we're here at our Boynton Beach location, partnering with the City of Boynton Beach and Feed South Florida to help those in our community.
Yeah, cars have been lining up here since 4 o'clock this morning, and our team has been here passing out coffee, praying with people in their cars, and just letting them know that they are loved and that they are not forgotten.
I want to thank Christ Fellowship for stepping up and just being a partner. Feeding South Florida came in, but with the assistance of Christ Fellowship, we were able to change lives. And that, to me, is really amazing.
I want to thank Christ Fellowship for going out of their way and really giving back to the community and to the world.
You have no idea how much you are helping families in need right now and how it's impacting people in a positive way.
This helps me with at least a week or so of cooking, and I have two little ones, so I'm just very, very thankful. Thank you.
Today, church, we are underwriting all the costs for this food bank distribution for an estimated 1,000 families in our region. And your generosity is making a difference right now, right here.
And this is just one of the many ways that we're reaching out to the community this week. We're serving meals out in Belglade.
We're delivering food to the elderly all throughout our region.
And we're serving dinner 3 times a week to our first responders heading to 20 police stations and fire stations. You've heard us say that the doors of our buildings might be closed, but the church is more open than it has ever been before. So thank you so much for your generosity in this season.
You know, as we prepare to give our offerings and our tithe back to God today, there was a scripture that my dad shared with us a week or so ago, found in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, about a group of Christians that were going through some troubles, even financial struggles of their own, but they still were generous with those that are in need. It reminded me of you. And then the Apostle Paul says in the very next chapter that generosity like this will result in people turning to God and praising God. And I want you to know that we are seeing that happen even here today through your giving.
Yeah, our giving is making a huge impact in the community, and it's also helping the church stay strong and move forward in this season. You know, the church is still the hope of the world because Jesus is the hope for the world, and we are his hands and feet, his body, as we reach out to the community with his love.
That's right. You can see the different ways to give right there on your screen. You can use the give button if you're on the website, or simply just take out your phone. It's simple. Text the word give to 441-441 and we'll send you a secure link.
Yeah, or you can still mail your check into the church, and our team is here to receive that if that's easier for you.
Church, this is really a sacred time where we get to partner with God to do his work
right here in our community. So let's pray together.
Yeah, Jesus, we just thank you for every good and perfect gift comes from your hand. And we thank you that in this season, as your church, we can be an extension of your hand and a reflection of your heart. We pray, God, that you would use these offerings to impact lives in this community and around the world. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
God bless you, church.
Come on, we continue in worship today. We sing this out in faith, declaring that we give God all the glory for what he's brought us through. Come on, can we sing this together today? I give you glory for all you brought me through. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. I'm moving forward to follow.
For us. I believe a breakthrough is coming. That song has been ministering to me all week long that I made the team sing it for us. I'm going to have them sing it for us before we're done today because I want that declared over my life. I want that declared over your life, that by faith we're going to see God move. The Bible tells us what faith looks like. It says this in Hebrews 11, verse 1. Faith is confidence in what we hope for. And the, say it with me out loud if it's there on your screen, the assurance about what we do not see. It's being sure of what we cannot see in the natural because we are looking with supernatural vision. We're seeing that God is on the move. We're seeing that His hand is moving. And so we're going to walk by faith, not just by what we can see with the physical. You know, this book is full of promises today, promises that you can hold on to. And I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what struggle you might personally be in, but I'm here to tell you, I know the one that can get you through the struggle. And I'm believing that today He's going to let His light shine down on the darkest part that you might be facing today, that He's going to move a mountain because He is a mountain moving God, that He's going to make a way and part the waters because that's what He does. So you and your family can get across on the other side. And today, if you're joining in and maybe your faith is running a little bit low, right? You've spent a lot of it. I want to let you know you can borrow some of my faith today, that I got enough for the both of us, okay? And so right here, right now, we're just going to believe God that we're going to see this breakthrough in Jesus' name, amen? Hey, we're so glad that you're with us. And it's so good having you here. I want you to know that even though we can't be together in the same building, we are together, right? There's no boundary here because where the Spirit of the Lord is, where He's with you and He's with me, we are one in Him. And so right now, I just want you to know Julie and I are praying for you. We've been praying for you, praying for your family. We hope that you are well and safe and strong and keeping your eyes on Jesus through all of this. And I know that all of us are facing different things right now. I've been talking with so many of you. Some of you are just praying that you'll make it through with your kids at home. And you're like, oh, they're here all the time. I know. And I'm praying for some of you that have businesses and you're struggling to know what it's going to look like on the other side of this. Regardless of what you're in today, I want you to know there is one that is with you. His name is Jesus, and He's walking with you today, right now. You know, over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about how to deal with doubt. And the truth is, we all have to deal with doubt. We just don't have to let doubt take us out. We've been asking the question, God, why? Why are you letting all this happen? And even beyond the pandemic question, but it's really like, God, why do bad things happen in my life? Why are you allowing, if you're so good, these bad things to happen in my life? And we've determined over the last couple of weeks that questions are good because they bring us to God. Anything that brings you to God, He will use it for your good. And so today I want to talk about another emotion that many of us are dealing with in this season. I know I'm dealing with this. And as I talked to some of you, you told me you're dealing with this. And it's the emotion of disappointment. Could be just disappointment that this has lasted so long. Could be the disappointment of something that was lost in this season. Like I know our high school seniors, you're a little disappointed that your final year kind of ended up this way. I'm disappointed for you. Some of you might be disappointed in your company or in your boss and the way they're handling it, or you've lost your job, or you're disappointed in the way somebody in Washington's not doing what you think they should do. Maybe even worse, you're just disappointed in yourself or in somebody that's close to you. Here's what I know. If you're not dealing with disappointment today, just wait. It's coming. Maybe in the next hour or two, you're gonna feel something that you're gonna be disappointed in, and it's going to try to take you out. For me, the first time I remember back when I had to really deal with disappointment, it was with this girl named Mindy. She had brown hair and brown eyes, and she was an older woman that I confessed my love to. Actually, I confessed my love to her best friend and asked her to go confess my love to Mindy. And when she did, when Mindy found out, Mindy didn't want to have anything to do with me. Mindy was like, I don't want to talk to you. She avoided me at school. She walked on the other side of the hallway when she saw me coming. I wasn't just disappointed, I was devastated. Like I really thought my life was over at age 11. Like I was like in fifth grade and she was like in seventh or eighth grade. This older woman is long before I met you, Julie. Don't worry, you got everything on Mindy. She got nothing on you today. But in this season, the truth is, the disappointment that we're dealing with goes way beyond a schoolboy crush, right? Some of you have lost your job. Some of you have watched your retirement dwindle away. You're looking at the future and you're going, I don't even know what's going to happen. And I've said this before, but I want to say it again. Disappointment does not come from God. Hear me on that. God does not disappoint. God only appoints. God has a purpose and a plan for your life. And when disappointment comes in, it's trying to move you off of that God-given appointment that He has for you. I've told you before that dis, that prefix, D-I-X, when it's put in front of any other word means it's moving in the opposite direction of that word. So distrust means trust is broken. Disrespect means respect is gone. And disappointment is going to try to move you away from the God-given appointment that he has on your life, the destiny he's got for you. So you got to make sure you're aware that when disappointment comes in, you understand what it's trying to do. And so this week, I couldn't get away from a story about a guy who had every right to ask the question, God, why is this happening? Why is this happening to me? He had every right to be disappointed in God. He had every right to be disappointed in the people around him because he had been mistreated. He had been abused. He lost everything. And he could have let this disappointment take him out. But in fact, when you read the story, the very thing that he thought was going to take him out was actually setting him up for God's purpose on his life, for God's appointment on his life. I'm talking about a 17-year-old teenager by the name of Joseph. Now, Joseph's family was like the definition of dysfunction. There were two stepmoms and all these stepbrothers living in the same tent together. Be glad you weren't, you know, you didn't have a stay-at-home order with those guys. That would have been awful. And on top of that, there were two more ladies in the house that Joseph's dad had relationships with, and there's all these kids running around. It was a hot mess in this tent, let me tell you. And Jacob, Joseph's dad, played favorites. He had a favorite wife, which was Rachel. That went over real well. And then he had a favorite child, which was Joseph. And everybody knew it was Joe. So here's, let me read you this passage of scripture out of Genesis chapter 37, verse 3. It says, Jacob, that's his dad, loved Joseph more than any of his other children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day Jacob had a special gift made for Joseph, a beautiful robe, but his brothers hated Joseph because their father loved him more than the rest of them. And they could not say a kind word about him. So you think your family has some problems? They had some serious problems going on. And on top of all this, Joseph was a dreamer. He had these dreams that everybody in his family was gonna bow down and worship him. And when he told them about it, it made him hate him even more. So the story goes on. Sometime later, when the brothers were all away taking care of the herds, the flocks, the father sends Joseph to go check up on his brothers. So Joseph heads out in his pretty gown to check up on his brothers, and they see him coming. And it says that they take him and they throw him in a pit. While they have him in the pit, they're discussing how they're gonna kill him. So just stop for a minute. What had to be going through Joseph's mind right there? He's like, I know you didn't like me, but this is crazy. There's no way he saw this coming. He had to be sitting in that pit going, I didn't see this coming. If I had known this was coming, I wouldn't have even come out here today. There's no way that he could have prepared for this. And in that moment, he probably thought it was over. And I started thinking about some of you, that right now you feel like you're in that pit with Joseph. Everything around you feels dark. You've lost your way. You probably feel like it's over. Let me tell you, there is always a pit stop on the way to the palace. There's always a pit stop on the way to the palace. I've watched a few races. I got to go to a race one time, but in every NASCAR race, the car has to pull in to the pit stop, right? And the pit stop has a purpose. And the purpose of the pit stop is not to end the race. The purpose of the pit stop is so that the driver can finish the race. They might need to get new tires. They might need to get fuel in the car. They might need a piece of the engine to be replaced. But the pit stop has a purpose. It's so that the car can recalibrate and get strengthened for the rest of the race. And I want to tell somebody who might feel like they're in a pit with Joseph, the pit stop doesn't mean it's over. It's actually an opportunity for God to give you what you need in this season so that you can finish what's ahead of you, so that you're ready for what is to come. It's not the end. So Joseph's brothers decide while he's in that pit not to kill him, but instead to sell him off to this caravan that's heading down to Egypt. And he's sold into slavery and he ends up in the house of Potiphar, the captain of Pharaoh's army. And it says this in chapter 39, verse 2, that the Lord was with Joseph and he prospered. And he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. And his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything that he did. Joseph found favor in his eyes. He became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his whole household, entrusted his care to everything he owned. You know what jumped out to me in that passage? Those first few words in verse 2, that the Lord was with Joseph. Right there in Egypt, right there in slavery, the Lord was with Joseph. In fact, in this story, over and over again, you'll see that phrase, that the Lord was with Joseph. And you might first hear that and think, really? I'm pretty sure that Joe didn't see God when he was stuck in that pit and he heard what his brothers were saying. Was God with him on the road down to Egypt when he was in that slavery caravan? But it says over and over that God was with him. God was with him, which reminds us that God is with us even when we don't see him. He's closer than we even know. And I want to tell somebody today, he's with you. Even when you can't see him, he's closer. He's just a breath, a prayer away. I've said this before, but the presence of a problem doesn't mean the absence of your God. You got to remember that. Some of us are in some problems right now. You're seeing some problems you don't know how to get through. I want to tell you, just because there's a problem doesn't mean God is gone. God is with you. God is for you. He promises to never leave you and never forsake you. See, we got to remember that we know how this story ends. We know the end of the story. We don't just see the snapshot of the pit or the fact in a minute he's going to be thrown into prison. We know that at the end of this, he ends up in the palace and that he ends up the second most powerful person in all of Egypt. But Joseph, let me tell you, he didn't know that back in the pit. All he thought was that his world was over. And so we got to remember that God is working. Even in those darkest places of your life, even when you can't see it, he's working. Don't give up halfway through the journey, man. Now, some of you might be listening today and go, Todd, this just sounds like it's too much of, you know, positive thinking, just a mumbo jumbo. Let's just believe it. Let's just, you know, I believe a breakthrough is coming. I don't know if I believe a breakthrough is coming. And I just want to tell you, it's okay if you don't believe it. It's okay if you don't believe that God can redeem any situation or any problem, because my Bible says that God will meet you at the place of your expectation, all right? So that's faith right there. So as for me and my house, we're gonna believe. We're gonna believe that a breakthrough's coming. We're gonna believe that God is a miracle working God. And I know, all I got is Julie here going, amen. I need some of you to jump in the chat right now and say, Pastor Todd, I believe too. You need to just get in there and give me some amens, because I'm used to hearing you a little bit. Let me hear you go. Just say, I believe I see my miracle. My miracle is coming. I believe a breakthrough is coming. I'm gonna confess with my mouth what I believe, that God is able, that no eye has seen and no ear has heard what God has in store for me. Write that in the chat. I don't have time to tell you the part of the story with Mrs. Potiphar, and she makes her moves on Joe, and then she lies about him and he gets thrown in prison. And once again, when he gets in prison, Joseph had to ask the question, God, are you kidding me? Is this really happening? I do what's right and I'm treated wrong? How can this work together for my good? And what I want you to hear is right there, once again, Joseph had to make a choice. Am I gonna let this disappointment in these people that I was only doing what's right, am I gonna let this disappointment destroy me? Because it could have. He could have gone into that prison, crawled in a hole, gotten in his cell. I'm not gonna talk to anybody. I'm not gonna do anything. I'm gonna throw a pity party is all I'm gonna do. But let me tell you, sometimes when things feel like they're falling apart, they're really falling into place. Because here's what you need to know. In this very same prison where Joseph is thrown, Pharaoh's cupbearer and Pharaoh's baker has been thrown in prison as well. So when he was put in this same prison, it wasn't falling apart. This wasn't a setback. It was a setup. God was actually setting him up, right? To Joseph, it might have looked like a setback, but no. To God, he had a different perspective on the story. And so in the prison, the Pharaoh's cupbearer and the Pharaoh's baker have some dreams that they can't interpret. And so Joseph interprets the dreams for them and they come true. And he said, listen, when they come true, just don't forget about me. He says, don't forget about me. And then in Genesis 40, 23, the chief cupbearer, however, did not remember Joseph. Look at that, he forgot about him. So how do you do that? How do you get out? And the guy that even told you were gonna get out, you like forget all about him. But once again, it was an opportunity for disappointment to move Joseph away from his appointment. Can I just tell you, don't let the people who've let you down keep you down. There's gonna be people that let you down in life. They might even be sitting in the same room with you. Don't let the people that have let you down keep you down. It reminds me of what the Apostle Paul said, and he wrote in Philippians 3:13. He says, this one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and reaching forward ahead to what is ahead, I take hold of that for which Christ Jesus have taken hold of me. I press on to the mark of the prize of the high calling of Christ Jesus, the very purpose that he set for me. I'm reaching for that. And the only way I can reach forward is I gotta forget what is behind. Listen, let go of what let you down so that it doesn't keep you down. God's got a great future ahead of you. And if you choose to hold on to the hurt and hold on to the disappointment, it's only gonna destroy your future and keep you from everything God has for you. So the cupbearer forgot about him. 2 years later, not 2 weeks later or 2 months later, Pharaoh's having some trouble. He's sleeping, waking up, having these dreams. Nobody can interpret the dreams for him. And that's when the cupbearer goes, oh, that's right. There was this guy in prison. His name is Joe. So they go get Joseph, comes before Pharaoh. He interprets Pharaoh's dreams and says there's going to be 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. And here's exactly what you need to do to prepare for the famine. This is what God's told you. And so Pharaoh, so overwhelmed with Joseph's insight and giftedness, puts him in charge of the whole thing. And seemingly overnight, he goes from the prison to the palace, but it actually wasn't overnight. It was a 13-year journey. Now, into this famine, up the road a little bit in a land called Canaan, Joseph's family is feeling the effects of the famine, but they hear that all this food is stored down in Egypt. So they get in a caravan, the brothers do, and they head down to Egypt and they find themselves bowing before the governor of Egypt, who happens to be Joseph. Just as Joseph had seen in the dream 20 years or so ago, which reminds me that delay does not mean denial, right? There's some things that God has shown you that you've got to hold on to in faith. It may take a few more years of prayer before you see your spouse or your kids walking with God. You keep praying. You keep believing. It may take a few more months of prayer and fasting before you see the breakthrough in your health and the healing that your body needs. You keep praying, you keep believing God because he is a breakthrough kind of God, or for that marriage to be restored like we celebrated today. You believe God for that. Hold on to the breakthrough that God has for you. It might just take a little bit longer than you thought. So his brothers are bowing down before him, and after he hides his identity from them for a while, Joseph finally reveals himself and says, hey, I'm your brother Joseph. And they are totally freaked out. Like, they are thinking, we are so dead right now. But when you read the story, Joseph doesn't retaliate. He doesn't punish them. He doesn't try to prove his point. He actually forgives them. And I believe, it's not written down here, but I believe he actually forgave them before that moment. Because in that moment when he was filled with the emotions, the raw emotions of what was happening right then, that wasn't the time he was probably making the decision, am I gonna forgive him or not forgive him? They were his brothers right there. They hadn't even asked for forgiveness yet, but he forgives them. See, what stands out in this story isn't just that there's a pit stop on the way to your palace, or that even when I can't see it, God is working. That's all true. And that's all in this story. But this story is a story about the power of forgiveness. That forgiveness will open the door to your future. See, I believe if Joseph had held on to unforgiveness, if he had held on to disappointment towards his brothers or towards Potiphar's wife or towards God, if he had focused on his past, he would have forfeited his future. See, anywhere in this story, he could have gotten so consumed by what was done to him that he would have missed out on what God had waiting for him. Now, it's one thing to be disappointed in what's happening in the world around you. Like, there's a lot of things going on right now that be disappointed in. But it's even something different when that disappointment comes in your own home. It's not out there, it's in your relationships, it's in your family, and that's what he's experiencing. That kind of disappointment, that weighs heavy on us. And the only way to deal with that kind of disappointment is you and I have to do what Joseph did. We have to forgive the people that have let us down. And I recognize that it's human nature to hold on to the hurt. That's why I'm suggesting we go beyond our human nature and we look to the nature of Christ. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 13, the Apostle Paul tells us this. He says, bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you might have against one another. Say that last part with me out loud right there where you are. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Say that last part again. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. So think about how you've been forgiven. Completely. Without any reservation. God just lavished his grace and his mercy upon us. And so he says, the secret to moving past your pain, those things that would try to hold you back, is you've got to forgive others the same exact way that Jesus forgave you. And there's times, if I'm honest, that I don't want to. Somebody's hurt me, said something about me or my family or done something, or I don't even know that I'm able to. You know what I have to do in those moments? I have to pray, God, would you remind me of how much you've forgiven me from? Would you remind me of your grace that you've poured on my life? And would you allow that grace to flow through me to the other person that I need to forgive? If you don't release it, it's gonna hold on to you. If you hold on to that hurt is gonna hold on to you. Decades ago in the continent of Africa, monkey meat was a delicacy. I don't know if people still eat monkey meat. I've never had monkey meat, but back in the day, it was a thing. But monkeys are hard to catch. So the villagers concocted this scheme. They took these jars that put peanuts in the bottom of the jars, and the monkeys would smell the peanuts, and they would come out of the trees and try to get to the peanuts. But the villagers had taken the jars and tied the jars to a tree. And so when the monkeys would stick their hand in the jar to grab the peanuts, when they pulled their hand out, their wrists would get caught on the narrow neck of the bottle because they were holding on to the peanuts. And as hard as they tried, they could not get free from the jars. And the villagers would wake up the next morning. They would see all these monkeys that were stuck in the jars. They had monkey stew for dinner. Here's the point. The monkeys lost their freedom because they could not let go. And the same is true with us, with hurt and disappointment. If we hold on to it, it holds on to us. We have to release it and let it go so that we can move on into the future God has for us. You know, in this story of Joseph, there was so much that was out of his control. Kind of reminds me of this season. There's so much in this season that we can't control, but there are some things from this story that we can learn to control when it comes to dealing with disappointment. The first is this: you gotta change where you're looking. Change where you're looking. God's future for you is not in the rearview mirror. Don't look back because you're not going that way, right? If you're focused on the past, you could miss the future God has waiting for you. But sometimes when we deal with a struggle or a problem, we get focused on that problem or the people that caused the problem. But Psalm 121 says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. So I'm gonna look up. See, if Joseph had focused on his situation, how he'd been beaten up by his brother, sold into slavery, lied about, thrown in prison, he would have ended up depressed, discouraged, and defeated. Instead, through it all, he keeps his eyes on God. Keep your focus on God. Keep looking up to God. Keep looking to his word, to his promises. We say, God, you made me a promise. Well, you can't hold on to the promises if you don't know the promises. So look to God's word. Change where you're looking. The second thing is you got to change what you're feeling. You got to change what you're feeling. Sometimes we think our feelings are the facts, but they're not. Your feelings are real. You really feel what you're feeling right now. But so many times your feelings are so far from the facts. And this is really all about keeping the right attitude when you're dealing with disappointment. Joseph kept the right attitude. Nowhere in this story do we read that he got bitter against his brothers or angry with Mrs. Potiphar or that he turned his back on God. No. In fact, what we read is the opposite. He cared so much about his relationship with God that he made him run from Mrs. Potiphar. I heard someone once say that life is 10% of what happens to you and 90% of how you respond to it, right? If you get up on the inside, nobody can hold you down on the outside. Change your feelings today. Don't be controlled by your feelings. You control those feelings today. And the last one is you gotta change what you're seeing. You've got to see with spirit eyes. You've got to understand that God is working even when you can't physically see it. So I'm going to look for the plan of God. We know there's a plan. Jeremiah 29:11 tells us, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future today." And that's what we believe God for. The verse at the very end of this story, Joseph said in Genesis 50, he was talking about this plan of God. He says, "You meant this for evil, but God meant it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." I want you to keep your eyes on Jesus in this season. I believe that if we can change what we're where we're looking, that we look up, if we can change what we're feeling and not be controlled by our feelings, and we can see the plan supernaturally that God has for us through this time, we're gonna come through this time stronger, looking for the miracle. I've asked the team to declare this song over us and over your households one more time before we go today. But before they do that, I want to pray for you. I don't know what you needed to hear today. Maybe you just needed to hear that there's a pit stop on the way to the palace, that this isn't the end. Maybe for some of you, you need to change where you're looking. You've been so focused on the problem. You've been so focused looking at the news that you've not heard the good news lately that God's going to bring you through it. Or maybe you need to deal with forgiveness. Maybe the disappointment is real close to home and you need to give that over to God today. I want to pray for you. And then I want to pray for those of you today that need to get your relationship with God right, because the only way you'll experience His peace is as you open up your life to a relationship with Jesus. Let me pray for you. Father God, I thank you for your word that reminds us of who you are, that reminds us, God, that you are working even when we can't see it. That behind the scenes, as you are working this all out for Joseph, you will do that for us, because you don't love Joseph more than you love us today. So God, I pray that every person here, that we would change where we're looking, that we would change what we're seeing, that we'd change what we're feeling today, and that we would stand on these promises, that you made us a promise and we won't stop now. As we continue to pray, if you need to get your relationship right with God, the only way you'll experience that peace and that assurance that He is working for you is as you open up your life to Jesus today. So I want to lead you in a prayer right where you are. And if you would say, "Todd, this is my prayer today to get my life right with God," right where you are, would you just raise your hand? There might be other people with you in the room, but you just raise your hand up and say, "This is my prayer today." And then pray this after me. Say, "Dear Lord Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me of all my sin. Fill me with your peace and your power. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen." Come on, let's sing this again one more time.
And I know breakthrough is coming.
Guys, we love you so much. Praying that this week is going to be awesome. Julie, it's a great week for the ladies of the house.
Yes, great week for the ladies of the house. Tomorrow night, or Sunday night, we have our sisterhood night live with just some of our girls of the house. And then Friday night, May 8th, right? May 8th.
Let's go with it.
Friday night, May 8th at 7 o'clock, we have our sisterhood night with Christine Kane. Girls, you are not going to want to miss it. So make sure you invite a friend and we'll see you online. It's going to be amazing.
Church, we love you. Have a great week in Jesus. Why don't you sing it one more time, since I thought you were going to sing it one more time, right? Let's go.
I see you.
We'll see you next week. Thank you so much for enjoying church with us.